Okay, and thank you for the introduction and for cheering up the audience. I hope that you are not sleeping after the lunch. So in order to check if you are sleeping or not, just raise your hand if you are not sleeping. Excellent, so I'm really happy. Today we'll speak a bit about user stories, and I hope that we'll have a lot of fun because the topic is connected with technical and non-functional requirements, which usually are quite difficult for us in terms of, okay, how we can actually fit those stuff into the constraints of the user story. So we try to understand how to build the requirements and actually answer the question if we should fit it to the format of the user story, because maybe not always the case. And my name is Katarzyna Mrowca and I will be your host today. So a bit about me. I'm Agile fan and Agile enthusiast, and beside this conference I'm also organizer of an Agile Lean Enthusiast meetup in Krakow. I was co-organizer of Agile Lean Enthusiast Europe in Krakow. This year we have edition in Sofia, and I encourage you to take part in Call for Papers because it's open till 26 May. And according to the lot of conversation I had in a hall, I see that there is plenty of people that have something to tell, and I think it's a great place to share. So let's end the quick advertisement. Here is as well my Twitter handle. So if you would like to comment or do you like some kind of the things I'm presenting, feel free to tweet. And also, before I start, I want like you to first to think about the format we are doing the requirements. I want to criticize the stuff that we are doing, but in a manner that, okay, it's not wrong. I don't want to say that something we are doing wrong and badly. Only that we may want to experiment, want to improve the stuff. So this is like the journey. So never the stuff we are doing will be perfect, and that's why it's good to check new stuff and how they are working, and I hope that I encourage you to that. And okay, before we start, my background. I started as a technical person, so I was programming, then I was network administrator, and because I have like pretty good communication skills, I became a business analyst, and I acted and I still act like a product owner for my Scrum teams. So my daily work is connected with, surprise, user stories. And because I would like to know a bit about you, please raise your hand if you are dealing with the user stories on a daily basis as well, as a developer, product owner, whoever. Okay, so I see that a lot of you have experience with those. And how many product owners or, let's say, people who are responsible for the requirements are here? Not so much, okay. Okay, so I hope that it will be nevertheless interesting. Because I was like technical before, then I transferred to the business side, so I was understanding more the technical stuff, not necessarily the business, so maybe the transformation was difficult in the beginning for me, but as well give me the insight for the products I worked on. And what were those products I worked on? They were technical. Or they were the parts of the product itself, so like integrations, infrastructures for products, basically, let's say the more technical stuff, or there were the products that were technical itself, so let's say it was the platform that was communicating between the systems. So I actually haven't the personas there. There weren't the human being who actually clicked somewhere and have that action. There was the system who asked, knock, knock, okay, I would like to have data from you. Give it to me. So this was the kind of the projects I have. And there were the two approaches I want to present and talk through, okay, how to deal with the requirements in a way that help us to build the great software. But before that, we'll speak a bit about the scenes connected with the technical non-functional requirements that we can see on our daily basis. So first of all, dependency. If we work in a project that is actually, you know, like the middle layer between several products, so we are building the Agile enterprise service bus or something like that. From our features and from our deployment to the productions, depends other deployments to the production. So usually other product owners and bunch of other people tend to put to our backlog the never-ending wish list with the timelines, the deadlines or whatever, because as I said, there is the dependency and it's quite hard to manage and usually it's quite messy as well. And this leads to the another evil stuff, which isn't evil itself, but if we put the commitment to it, so the dates, it actually is terrifying because this means that we have, for example, 2 years backlog with hard deadlines commitment because, hey, other products are dependent. So if you fail to deliver this API, if you're not delivering this part of the functionality in your systems, if your systems, you know, don't handle events, then other products will fail, simply fail, because there is dependency. So why it's so bad that we have this roadmap? Because we don't have time to make amends to the stuff that we already deployed to the production. So even if we have continuous integrations and we are deploying, you know, like almost instantly, and we don't have time to actually gather the feedback and amend the stuff, it's actually pointless. So we'll address this within a minute, how to actually deal with it and make certain that we can actually improve our product, not only delivering the next features, but maybe are not necessarily the best ones. Okay, the user stories itself, sometimes you have problem with quality, but before that, we can take a look how the user stories create, how is the template that we commonly use. So we have here three really valuable questions. We'll go back to them again within a few minutes. So this is who, what, and why. Okay. And sometimes we see the stuff like that. So let's say that we would like to add login, which is quite unfunctional and could be functional as well, to our systems, and we see the stories like that. Okay, it's like meaningless. It would be even better to write only, okay, just add login functionality than trying to figure it out something. However, sometimes we have more decent user story. So we have the persona here, we have the quite nice, the business behind it, so we see the, okay, our end customer wants to compare the prices, and we start thinking, okay, what we need to do in order to deliver that? Okay, so probably we need to reach the database from the airline A, airline B, airline C, maybe some other airline, and combined it, we need to care about a refreshment because the ticket prices are quite frequently changing, so it depends on the bookings as well. So we need to care about correct infrastructure for that. Probably there is also UI from this because the customers don't, you know, query, maybe, or maybe he want to query this with some query language, or maybe he would like to have, you know, UI with the buttons to receive the answer. So there's a lot of stuff that could be specified in acceptance criteria, of course. But what I'm talking about in a minute ago, it's like actually an epic, not the user story, because it's a big. We have a lot of unknown there, but yeah, sure, we can put to the acceptance criteria, then we can go to the developers, give them to it, and they say, okay, yeah. So it's not good user story in terms that it's simply general, and because it's general, it's hard to divide it for the smaller parts, because what? We divided, okay, as a customer, I would like to have the, you know, 50% of the outcomes. It's, you know, starting not to make any sense. So quickly, just to wrap up this part, what kind of the problems and what kinds of the struggles we have. Those are dependencies, the roadmaps, and the two general user stories. And all those together creates the problems that we struggle with the technical products where there is no users, or even if there are users, they are not direct. So it's usually really hard for the platforms and the big companies to be agile because of that, because the things that other people are actually giving to us, and because we, instead of saying, okay, no, we want, you know, commit to do it, just do it our way, and I show you what our way could be. Because as I said, if we are agile, so we are able to adapt, sometimes the stuff from the roadmap that are waiting 2 years can say, okay, we actually don't need it anymore. So it's pointless to keep it then, there and manage them. Remember, though, if we have the huge backlog, it means that someone have to manage it. Someone have to take care of prioritization, the prioritization, estimation, and stuff like that. And this is really painful. And a bit about the background. So I'm speaking about from the perspective of the huge companies. Sometimes, you know, introducing Agile there is really painful, but I would like to, you know, show you that there is a hope and there could be better, and we don't have to follow like the waterfall kind of work, even on technical products and technical stuff like integrations. Okay, so how we can actually improve, how to make better? So remember those questions, yeah? They are from the user story, and as I said, they are really valuable, but because we somehow focus so much on the format, we actually forget to asking the questions, because we're thinking, okay, so how I can fit it to the as a user kind of way? I have no user. Oh my gosh. So maybe as a DBA, as a whatever, and then the problems happen. Okay. And also the order. I personally like to answer the question why first, why we are doing the stuff. So if we have the technical requirements, sometimes we want to do it because of the performance issues. So this request that I'm talking about from the example, so the customers want the comparing the prices. Okay, so maybe there is performance issue as well. So maybe already he can get some responses, but it takes like 5 minutes, or I don't know, 2 seconds, which in current world is like ages, because who do we know like wait 2 seconds, come on. So there could be a stuff like communication between systems. So this is the integration, but translated for the business words, because usually you say, okay, we need to integrate to a business stakeholder, they will just, you know, make the scary face, oh my God, what does it mean? So basically it means that, okay, knock, knock, we would like data, that's it. So we can translate it in a really straightforward way, but we need to ask why we are doing it. So in the case of our poor customer, our poor tourist who would like to book the tickets, actually several parts of this non-functional stuff can apply. So it's not so straightforward answer, and because it's not so straightforward, it's sometimes really tricky to put it in a one user story. So this is the point when we are writing it down, and then we'll be thinking about how to decompose it for the smaller parts as well. Remember, several parts, thinking about everything, not only the one. Okay, so we wrote it down, and then we have next question. Okay, so what we are doing with that? Here we can have again a lot of possibilities to do, and it's not of course ending, but typically if we have non-functional requirements, they could be connected with refactoring. So if we have already the functionality but it's slow, maybe if we refactor it, it will be maybe better, maybe we can improve something. Maybe it could be like infrastructure. So let's say that we have no automatic tests, no automatic regression tests. So maybe if we add them, it means that our overall performance of the team or the number of bugs on the production will decrease. Maybe it will be better. So it could be the solution as well. Communication, so the integration. So actually, maybe if we connect more systems, we receive better results. Of course, if we have bugs, which are quite like technical, that's not necessarily connected with the product itself, but again, with our infrastructure behind. Or maybe if we have spikes because we don't know the technology and want to, you know, learn if we can use it in some creative way. Again, this is non-functional. So those are the examples, and I would like to take integration as a one of it. So we need to ask the question, okay, if we have integration, what do we need to know in order to complete it like the whole picture? So again, having the customer who, you know, ask for the ticket prices, and we know that we have to integrate with several systems, we have to go to the business and ask the questions. That seems to be a bit technical, you know, and every time you just see it, okay, how the business people would know, but they will. For example, event-based or scheduled. Scheduled basically means, okay, let's say that we feed the data once a day, once a month, once a week. Event-based, okay, something happens. So for example, customer clicks something and then the data pop up. This reflects our technical and architecture and infrastructure. So we need to ask our customers, okay, if the customer clicks for the ticket prices, do we want to have fresh data? Because maybe we don't care that we display the, let's say, ticket prices, which were like valid a week ago. Then maybe customer will be a bit angry if we try to book, and then instead of having like 20 euros for Ryanair flight, he see like 1,000 euros. But maybe we don't care. So this is the question that we have to ask. The same is with the collisions. So let's say that we have the backend systems that provide us the ticket prices, and we have several systems that can change the ticket price. So for example, the booking system, which now the ticket is booked, so the reservation systems kick off and change the ticket prices for the rest of the systems. So this synchronization also will influence what our end customers who are asking for the price will receive, and with what actually he should see. Because maybe booking, it's not necessarily the same as buying, because then you have transaction, you'd have to confirm that the ticket is actually paid. So there are several business questions behind of those, because I see that I have 10 minutes left, I just carry on. Okay, so if you have those, it's nice to have as well the sequence diagram, so in order to view what's happening step by step in our system. You can use UML, but if you use basically only the arrows just to see the steps, see the sequences, how the transactions are going, it's good enough. I'm a fan of not over-engineering the stuff that we are using, because one more important stuff we should remember about the old documentation we are doing, it's outdated one day after, or even 1 minute after we finish it, because reality is changing. So no over-engineer, please. And the last question, which is also really important, okay, who is using it? In terms, not necessarily, because it could be like the end business user somewhere, so the tourist, but do you think that our tourists will ever read the user story we've written? Just raise your hand if yes. Okay, you are only smiling, so yeah. So not necessary, so the level of the details or the level of the being like business oriented for this case maybe is not necessarily so valid. So if our target audience are developers, testers, DBAs, maybe data analysts who really query the data for the ticket price, the level of the user story that we are writing can be different. So maybe we can use more direct terminology instead of trying, okay, to describe what we are doing. So this is also fine. I know the user stories, the heart of it should be like bringing the human being touch to the technical stuff, but sometimes it's only over engineering. So we always have to take into consideration our context. Okay, so we know who. So what next? Usually we are writing down our requirements in some kind of the backlogs and stuff like that. Some people for the non-functional have like magic list and then forget it for, you know, forever. But usually what we should do, of course, making the list of the items. But as I said, if we're having too long this list, managing it is like the nightmare. And today we were speaking about the metrics. I would like to present you metrics in a slightly different manner. Those metrics I'm presenting here are rather intuitional, and they're asking the question why we are doing it. So we are not saying here like the exact numbers, but we are actually evaluating if we want to do the stuff or not. And the best way to evaluate is like picking up 3 up to 5 stuff that you would like to track in the terms, okay, for example, the best way is example. So we have this booking system. So if we add this functionality, is it improve the performance, for example? Is it improve the code maintenance? Because this is, you know, important for us as well. And for example, is it improved the usability? Those stuff are really hard to measure with numbers. So that's why we can have only like axes with those nice faces here. And if we are having the feeling, okay, I think, I'm not certain, but I will validate it later, that this particular user story will improve the stuff with those areas I'm really concerned about. As I said, up to five key areas, not more, because then complexity is too big. Okay, so we can keep it in our backlog. If it's not improving the stuff, and it's rather like the wish list that will only wait in our queue and we'll have to manage it, just throw it away, because it's pointless. If you are in an organization, because I know that some organizations are really terrified of deleting or actually removing the scope. If you are from such organization, create special separate backlog with, you know, like archived or whatever, that you know that you never will look there, and managers who are terrified of deleting will be, you know, like, oh my gosh, this is in the backlog, it's waiting in the queue, fine. So if you must, you can do it. It's not the best practice though. It's better to try to say to the business, sorry, really, it's irrelevant. You are wasting your money because you have to employ someone who reads those stories and then nudge them. So better delete. Okay. So if we have the rough estimates, rough metrics, we of course want to have only those that are improving our situation. Again, then we have to have some way to validate our ideas, you know, because we had the idea, okay, this will improve the situation. Okay, but how? So again, because I'm really fan of having stuff high level, because estimates are guessing. So I think there's no point of wasting our time on complex mathematics, and you can disagree. I'm really happy to discuss after the talk, but in my current experience in big companies with the big projects, it was waste of the time, and waste of time is waste of the money. So having only the rough idea how big it is, it's enough to say if we are improving stuff or not. So having, again, the example with the user story connected with the bookings, let's say that we would like to have the query response quicker. Again, we are giving the time range we expect to have, and we measure how currently it's working. So the stuff that we have currently, okay, it's nice to have the numbers. And then we have to have some goals we would like to achieve. And again, we have to communicate to the business that there are goals. It's not certain that we will achieve it. Because maybe we need not only the refactoring, maybe we need not only like renaming classes, maybe we need something more. So this is the idea behind, to have the time range, to have like percentages, so not definite stuff, just to not feed the expectation of the business that we will for certain receive something, but also just to cover the carving from the business side for some kind of the predictability, because always when they ask for the, you know, the estimates or the stuff like that, they would like to have something predictable behind it. Okay. And now to the question, should we use the user stories? And this question I will leave to you. I would like only that you keep in mind those questions I presented you before, and maybe you can enrich your user story, because I believe that format of the requirements in each organization should be up to decision of this organization. So always the context matters, because some developers simply love user stories and some hate those. So if we are meant to work together as a team, we have to, as a team, agree, okay, what format suits us. So remember, adapting. So giving, again, this example of the integration. So how we tackle this stuff. So we can have not only the, you know, we can divide it for the several small user stories connected. Okay, fair user stories connected with this performance. So we would like to have the response within like 1 millisecond instead of 2 seconds currently. We would like to connect with system A, B, C, and D. We would like to, for example, in order to present to our customer nicely, we would like to be able to present 15 rows, whatever it is, and stuff like that. So if we actually reverse the stuff, so we are putting the acceptance criteria as our stories, it's becoming smaller. And again, we can progress with our work because, for example, first we can focus on only displaying the output of the query, and then we can focus on improving the performance and the quality. So this means that we can deliver something fast and then improve it instead of doing everything at once and having like 1 year of waiting. Okay, so how to feed it to the tools? Because we usually use the tools. I work with the distributed teams, which currently are in Europe, so it's really, really good, because previously I worked with the teams with US, Europe, and Asia, so three time zones, so this was real fun. No way to have common stand-up. Using the tools is really important in terms that, okay, we have to agree how we would like to use our templates. So for example, if we have functional user stories as well, and we don't want to mix technical ones because the functionals are nice, they're, you know, they have personas that are well defined in the way that every person from the business understand, we can simply add a new type to the backlog. And the tools like Jira, version ones, allow us to give the custom type there. So why not use it? Name it like, I don't know, Pink Elephant or some other creative name, or maybe technical user story if you like, and have it like the separate stuff there. Okay, and you know, be creative in using the fields if you can amend it. Because, okay, there are tools that are configurable, but sometimes there are our company have a policy. I work in a huge company that have the policy that every tool, every team should use exactly the same way the tool, so you know, filling the same fields. So we just use the name slightly different. So in estimates, we, instead of the numbers, we keep the letters. Okay, nobody killed us for that. So we had the stuff that were called goals, but we need like the tags to determine what about this, you know, what is the dependencies between the stories. So instead of having like goals, we put there, okay, this is dependent on that, that, and that. Okay, we can, you know, you can use that way the tool if everyone in the team agrees. So this is again tricky if we have distributed team, but usually we can communicate to them and use it that way. We can have own template. So we don't have to use the as a user. We can be creative and starting as a pink elephant or pink elephant once or whatever. You can be as well quite funny in those stuff, just not to be, you know, like boring all the time in work. And remember that if we have definition already, it should be like connected with our template, because if there are like two separate stuff, which sometimes happens, then it doesn't work simply. Okay, so metrics and ways to measure. Just again, for those metrics I mentioned, so really high level and not so mathematics focused, are okay, how we narrow down the scope. And as I said, it's important just to control the size and keep the stuff we are doing agile. And the metrics just to validate if our infrastructure work actually help us. And if not, and we have like, you know, free time for the next sprint, we can actually take the story again, reopen it and fix it. Magic happened. You can't do it if you have 2 years backlog. And you may ask, okay, but if you are building the platform, you have those all horrid course, you know, dependencies, how to do it then? Again, communication that we are doing it is slightly different. And because of, you know, being able to finish stuff that we started, so having the feedback loop and amending afterwards, we are actually making more reliable stuff. So when I was building the platform for integration, the biggest problem was that, for example, some IPs didn't work, and because of the huge backlog, we couldn't actually go back to fix it. So, and then we had this, you know, strange like hot fixes on the production because something went wrong, and the whole plan like fell, and other, you know, products that were depending on us were really in a bad situation because they couldn't kick off with their stuff. So better just limit the expectations and say, okay, just go with the small steps instead of, you know, planning 2 years ahead. And finally, it would be good if our stories were quite independent. So if we are trying to divide our story, remember that it should be, you know, all the stuff that we actually apply to user stories, so you know that it should be testable, so it should be reflecting only single stuff, is applying to this as well. So this is a good thing to remember at the end. So quickly wrapping up, because I see that I'm already after the time, there are really nice questions from the user stories that we should, you know, keep using, but thinking about, you know, broader picture, not only answering the one that is the stuff, because it's sometimes really quite hard to see behind the format if we are really, really focused on it. We should remember that if we have the working list, there's nothing bad to getting rid of the some requirements. It's a bit like deleting of the code, you know? Developers are scared of deleting the code. We are scared of deleting the user stories, but actually it shouldn't be so bad. And we should remember about feedback loop and validating, okay, if our assumptions that from those high-level metrics are actually right, so if we did something good or not. And later on, it, of course, help us to make the better guesses with those metrics there. So remember, Agile is about adapting. I hope that I forced you to critical thinking today and that you'll try to use something new and you'll learn on your own experiences how to actually make the best non-functional technical requirements ever. So thank you for your attention. I don't know if we have time for questions.
Thank you very much, Kasia. All right, one question? Good, you were the first.
I've heard a lot about jobs to be done as a concept instead of user stories. Could you give a quick comparison? Why would you choose one or the other?
So I think that sometimes we don't have a choice and we have to use user stories because of the company constraint. I'm from such environment that the user story is basically the format that we are expected to deliver as a product owners. And now our job description is, okay, you are managing the backlog and writing down the user stories. But discussing the job to be done. So I think it all depends, again, on your team. Because sometimes it's easier to actually sit down with the team and instead of, you know, formal writing, do the experiments, deliver something and show to the business or show to our users or maybe other developers. So as I said, it depends on the company and if the company actually allow you to have a choice. So I think this is the tricky part.